Tantor Audio, a division of recorded books, presents Homo Sapiens Rediscovered, The Scientific Revolution Rewriting Our Origins, by Paul Pettitt, narrated by Julian Alpha. Prologue. We had already been underground for 5 or 6 hours, perhaps more. My sense of time always failed me in these places that were so far away from natural light. Those points of orientation we take for granted, sunlight, distant noise, held no sway here. My arms and legs ached, and a rumbling stomach reminded me that we'd not eaten since a light breakfast. We had been standing still for much of the time, staring at the cave's gritty wall, arms extended above our heads. There were 6 of us. We took it in turns to scrape the scalpel carefully over the glittering white surface or to hold the test tube beneath it. Scrape, scrape, scrape. One of us would shine a torch at the spot on the wall on which all eyes were focused. One would take notes, another photograph or film. The shelly stalactite came off painfully slowly. A small accumulation of bright white powder no bigger than a pinch of salt built up at the bottom of the test tube. It was rock after all. Scrape, scrape, scrape. It was April 2016, and when we finally emerged into the light of day and sat with the cold beers we'd been looking forward to, we had no idea how our results were to radically change what we thought we knew about the origins of art and Ice Age culture. The process that led us here had begun some 13 years earlier. One evening, at a college dinner in Oxford, a friend of mine, archaeology writer and Ice Age art specialist Paul Barn, expressed how he would love to look for cave art in the UK, but wouldn't know where to look. I would, I replied. A few weeks later, I'd organised a 4-day survey of the English and Welsh caves I thought were most likely to have any art if it was there. At Paul's request, we were joined by Sergio Ripoll, an Ice Age art specialist from Madrid's Distance Learning University. I certainly didn't expect to find any art. It's lucky I'm not a gambler. Our first stop was Creswell Crags, a narrow limestone gorge that straddles the counties of Nottinghamshire and Derbyshire in the English Midlands. Its several caves have long been known for their Ice Age archaeology. It seemed a sensible place to start our search. Sergio is famous for his eyes, and he had before spotted Ice Age art in several Spanish caves. It was still an immense surprise when he called down excitedly from a ledge above our heads in a cave called Church Hole. He had found an engraving of a red deer, which could only be Ice Age in date. As news of the discovery spread, English Heritage paid for scaffolding in Church Hole, which allowed us to examine the higher parts of the cave's walls where any additional surviving art would most likely be found. We discovered several more examples, about a dozen in total, all engraved, including the outline of a bison, an extinct aurochs, and enigmatic human-like images. That's when my colleague and old friend Alistair Pike came into the story. "That art you found in Church Hole," Alistair asked, "any of it covered in stalactite?" I answered enthusiastically, "Yes, I'd spotted several areas where the white stone had formed over the engraved lines of the cave's images." Our excitement was immediate. If that was the case, Alistair could use a special method called uranium-thorium dating to date stalactites that had formed over the art. If we ensured that we took our samples from the stalactite where it clearly overlaid the art, the results would provide a minimum age for the underlying engraving, or in other words, a date that the art must have been created before. We were soon back in Church Hole and busy with a drill. Back then, it's not that long ago, but science moves quickly, we needed a relatively large sample, a circle of the stalactite roughly 3 centimetres, 1 inch across. When Alistair's results came through a month or so later, they showed that the stalactite had formed towards the end of the Ice Age, about 13,000 years ago. The art underneath must have been older. Several years passed. Alistair and I began directing archaeological excavations at Creswell Crags in order to understand more of the behaviour of the Ice Age artists who had left their indelible marks on Church Hole's walls. There was a lot of cave art out there in France and Spain too, That's how we came to spend so much time underground in three Spanish caves, painstakingly scraping stalactite off dozens of examples of Ice Age art. Our main intention was to refine what we knew about how the art had evolved and how it changed in theme and style over the course of the last 25,000 years of the Ice Age. But things would turn out differently. Much of the art we dated fell within the expected range, from a couple of thousand back to over 25,000 years ago. But some of the results inspired Alistair to telephone me at home one late evening. Several samples, from all three of the caves we'd examined, had come out surprisingly old, much older than we'd expected. The results showed that the stalactites overlying art in La Pasiega cave in the north of the country, Maltreviso cave in the centre, and Ardalis in the south, had formed around 65,000 years ago. In all cases, the art had to be more than 65,000 years old. The implications were profound. This doubled the age of Ice Age art overnight. But far more importantly, it showed that the art could not have been made by Homo sapiens. We have a good understanding of when members of our own species first arrived in Europe during the Ice Age. In Spain, as elsewhere, this occurred around 42,000 years ago. Even if the art we'd dated turned out to be 65,000 years old and not much older, it would have been created 23,000 years before Homo sapiens first arrived in Spain. It had to be the creation of another type of human, and in all probability, it was made by the Neanderthals. Thinking this through raised more questions. Were the Neanderthals the first to produce art? If so, we were wrong in thinking that it was unique to Homo sapiens. Was their art different? The examples we'd dated were all non-figurative, marks made by covering parts of the body with pigment and using them to colour the walls. Perhaps our sapiens ancestors can still lay claim to producing the first figurative art. But were they producing this art as they dispersed across the Europe and Asia for the first time, or did it come thousands of years later? What does this say about the cultural evolution of our own species? Introduction. Who are we? How do scientists define Homo sapiens, and how does our species differ from the extinct humans that came before us and those with whom we were contemporary as recently as 40,000 years ago? In evolutionary terms, we are a crazy experiment. We sacrificed some of the tough, muscular bodies inherited from our ancestors and came to rely more upon tools. We grew brains that are huge by primate standards and so expensive metabolically that we needed highly nutritious packages of food in the form of meat to power them if we weren't to graze all day long. Obtaining this meat required the regular hunting of large, dangerous animals, which in the days before rifles was very difficult and often resulted in painful injuries. Why do this? As we will see, the changes that define our brains probably required only a few genetic mutations, but these had a profound effect, resulting in a possibly unique mental world. There must have been good reasons for such an expensive change. We owe much to our Ice Age ancestors. Just to think of a few things common to modern life: sewing needles and tailored clothing, jewelry, burial of the dead, art, dogs, weapons, tents, lamps, and, as I shall show, villages, and even a form of writing. Archaeologists can't interrogate our distant ancestors directly. We're reliant entirely on the stones, bones, and residues that have survived from the remote periods in which they lived. We have a battery of cutting-edge scientific techniques that we use to try to answer the questions we'd like to put to the people of the Ice Age. Many of these techniques are very new and are only now opening up fresh lines of research which are radically changing what we think we know about our origins. How difficult was it to survive the harsh and unstable climates of the series of ice ages scientists call the Pleistocene? How did you hunt those large, dangerous animals? How did you know how to find the mammoth herds in winter? How did you learn to make the hide-working and antler-carving tools, spears and javelins that were so essential to your survival? What was the purpose of your art? Was everyone allowed to produce it? Was your society one of equals, or was some more equal than others? Had you formed religious beliefs? Researchers into human evolution often disagree about the answers to many of these questions, as well as a host more that I will ask in the chapters to come. Through the evolution of our peculiar brains and the imaginative spin they allow us to put on things, coupled with the story of how we learn to survive in remarkably small numbers in a truly hostile world, the story of our origins spins out of the Ice Age. This is the story I want to present here. It's a story that has benefited from remarkable advances in biomolecular science, not least of which is the sequencing of ancient DNA, the revelations from which, understandably, hog the limelight. But I've always been interested in behavior, and understanding one without the other is a bit like knowing that someone is a great author without reading any of their books. We are far more than our DNA. It's a great human blueprint, but in this book I want to bring out what our Ice Age ancestors created with it. I should say very briefly who I am. I specialize in Paleolithic archaeology, literally the Old Stone Age, the study of the archaeology of the oldest, most distant archaeological period. I went to university a little over 30 years ago, intending to specialize in Roman Britain, but ended up falling back and back in time until I landed with a bump in the Pleistocene. These days I leave the Roman stuff to my wife. I research the behavior of our Stone Age, Ice Age ancestors, and in the following chapters I want to reveal the big picture of how modern science is used to study these people and what I think we now know about them. I will pepper them here and there with stories of what I've researched and who I've worked with in order to convey a sense of what research in field and cave, in museum and laboratory is like. I'll be taking you back into a remote and alien past to get under the skin and furs of the experience of Stone Age people. At times we'll be moving swiftly so as to set the scene, but I promise that in places we'll stop for a while and watch individuals at work. We'll do that particularly in Europe, as it's what I specialize in, where the period in question is called the Upper Paleolithic. There are many untold stories to reveal, so pull on your parka, leggings, mittens and boots, it's going to be very cold, pick up your javelins and pocket some smoked bison meat and putrefied fish heads for the journey. We've a long way to go. Chapter 1. Skin and Bones. Cheddar Gorge is a magical place. It's a steep-sided limestone valley in the UK associated today with the eponymous cheese and with walkers attracted to the Somerset beauty spot. But its ancient inhabitants were interested in an entirely different local resource, wild horses. With a little planning, the dangerous herds could be channeled through the gorge and ambushed where it narrows. In 1903, a human skeleton, an adult male, was excavated there just inside the mouth of Gough's Cave, nowadays a popular show cave. Radiocarbon dating off his bones has shown that he lived and died around 10,000 years ago, just after the end of the Pleistocene. His people were drawn from an ancient Ice Age stock, now adapting to the boreal forests spreading across Europe as the climate warmed into the Holocene, the current epoch. Cheddar Man probably died violently. A large break is visible on his cranium, and whether he was buried or simply came to lie where he died, he was gently covered by naturally accumulating sediments, and there he stayed until his accidental discovery 10 millennia later. I've often visited Cheddar, usually with university students, and I've always found this rugged landscape particularly evocative of the Ice Age world. In 2018, colleagues from London's Natural History Museum managed to extract surviving fragments of DNA from the densest bone in Cheddar Man's body, the petrous temporal bone, part of the base of the skull, which houses the machinery of the middle and inner ear. The results painted the most intimate portrait anyone would have of the man since his death. Like all Ice Age humans, he was lactose intolerant. That was to be expected. The ability to digest dairy products would arise only thousands of years later, when early agriculturalists domesticated cattle, sheep and goats. But the real surprise was his appearance. In life he was dark-skinned, blue or green-eyed, and had dark brown, curly or wavy hair. Much was made of the news in the little town of Cheddar, where today light skin and brown eyes are common, milk is drunk and cheese is made as in the rest of Northwest Europe. Several of the Cheddar locals shared some of his DNA, but important changes had clearly separated them from this man of our remote past. Cheddar Man was not alone. Even as late as 7,000 years ago, the late Mesolithic, as archaeologists call it, pale skin was not the European norm. Cheddar Man reminds us of a deep and distant ancestry we all carry today. He came back to us from the northwestern edge and youngest end of the Ice Age, but his skin and bones carried with him a far longer legacy, one that takes us back to the forests of Africa 7 million years ago, where the locomotion, diets, and brains of quadrupedal apes were about to undergo profound changes. African apes and human origins. We are all African apes. Although we have undergone important changes over the course of human evolution, we retain the major characteristics of our primate roots. Our hands are dexterous at grasping and manipulation, and come equipped with the nails of tree climbers rather than claws. And like other apes today, we're a social creature, living in complex webs of relationships. We primarily rely on our sense of vision rather than smell, and as the primate nasal area reduced in size, our eyes became positioned in the front of the head, enabling binocular, three-dimensional vision. For a mammal, however, we have a brain that's very big relative to the size of our body, with a correspondingly high energy demand. One of the major questions of human evolution is why we came to diverge from our ancestors and pay such a large metabolic cost for it. Victorian scientists such as Charles Darwin and Thomas Henry Huxley noted the remarkable similarity between the skeletons of apes and humans and correctly inferred a close evolutionary relationship between them. It seemed that with a few modifications, a quadrupedally walking ape could be turned into an erect walking human, and over the course of deep time, so they reasoned, this had happened by means of evolution through natural selection. From the mid-20th century, field workers like Lewis and Mary Leakey in Tanzania's Olduvai Gorge began to recover fossils of creatures apparently intermediate between living apes and humans, and to document the evolutionary experiments that lead to human distinctiveness. Today we're able to draw on cutting-edge genetics to refine our evolutionary story. As one geneticist put it, new discoveries in human evolution are as likely now to emerge from a genetics laboratory as the East African Rift Valley. Rather like researching a family tree, comparing the genomes of all four families of great apes traces them back to a common ape ancestor that lived in Africa between 10 and 16 million years ago. A branch leading to orangutans split off around 10 million years ago. Another leading to gorillas split between 6 and 10 million years ago, and we still shared a common ancestor with our sister group, the chimpanzees, as late as 5 million years ago. We know very little about this common ancestor, but we can use comparative anatomy of existing and extinct apes to conclude that it must have been a knuckle-walking, branch-hanging, and vertically climbing ape. The divergence between the chimpanzee branch and that leading ultimately to Homo sapiens occurred between 5 and 7 million years ago. Interbreeding between the two diverging groups probably continued for a million or more years, but it was infrequent enough for the genes to diversify, and in the case of early humans, to spread the mutation that had caused the two chromosomes of one individual to fuse. The non-human apes pursued successful adaptations of their own, but as an archaeologist, my interest is in humans, and we will soon have to part ways with chimpanzees and gorillas. We still share many traits with our living ape relatives, which is no surprise given that we also share over 98% of our genome with them. The initial divergence was probably limited, but some gene regions came to diverge considerably more than others, and we shouldn't underestimate the complexity of the differences that increasingly separated the two branches between 5 and 0.5 million years ago. A number of differences grew, including those that affect our susceptibility to diseases such as cancers, and those genes relating to brain development and function were particularly important. But long before they kicked in, other changes were quite literally afoot. Walking on 2 feet. The bodies of all living apes are anatomically adapted for below branch swinging, climbing and clambering, and when they're on the ground, they knuckle walk on their relatively long arms. African fossils dating to between 23 and 5 million years ago, the Miocene, show that apes were already experimenting with variants of these types of locomotion. Some spent more time knuckle-walking on the ground, others experimented with minor tweaks to swinging and climbing. So why did some come to rely solely on two limbs for locomotion? The answer lies in a changing environment. During the Miocene, Africa was covered in thick forests, broken only by rivers and lakes. Most primates lived up in the tree canopy. But around 8 million years ago, temperatures began to fall as ice built up at the planetary poles, and as a result, Africa went through a prolonged period of drying. The forests began breaking up and thinning out, increasingly separated by swaths of open grassland. The distribution of fruits and other foods became more patchy, and apes needed to cover more ground in order to obtain the necessary amounts of food. Some groups became extinct. Others managed to survive by doing the same thing. But other groups developed a simple form of habitual bipedal walking on the ground, a compromise between arboreal climbing and swinging and terrestrial walking. It wasn't just these African apes that took to their legs, nor did bipedalism guarantee evolutionary success. Around 12 million years ago, Danuvius guggenmusii, a small ape known from Bavarian fossil deposits, was clambering along branches on two legs, an experiment which clearly did not lead to more human-like descendants. For a relatively short-limbed primate, bipedalism is a more energy-efficient way of travelling on the ground than knuckle-walking. Chimpanzees and gorillas stand upright for short periods of time, particularly when they're feeding, and it's easy to imagine how some individuals simply took a couple more steps to reach another fruit tree. Early bipedalism may not have been much more efficient than quadrupedalism, or have looked particularly graceful, but a few extra steps here and there could amount to reaching the necessary quantity of fruit to survive. These initial steps started a process that would improve ape diet, balance the head on top of the body, and begin the walk towards humanity. The African fossil record shows that a number of apes between 5 and 7 million years ago were tweaking these early forms of habitual bipedalism. Some of the earliest walkers, such as the 4.4 million-year-old Ardipithecus ramidus of East Africa, retained an ape-like body with a few anatomical changes, such as shortened pelvises and feet that now resembled platforms for locomotion rather than a second pair of hands, that allowed something like a slow, bent-kneed, hip-rotating swagger. The new walking was occurring across much of Africa, although many groups would become extinct. Others, however, would continue to refine their bipedal anatomy alongside, among other things, increased brain size. Diet. The biological success of a species comes down to being able to maintain the body's functions and passing them on through reproduction. Understanding the food we eat and where we get it from is critical to understanding human evolution. Geological and ecological clues preserved in the sediments in which human fossils came to rest tell us what environments they lived in. But why did human diets become so diverse? When Miocene apes began to establish themselves in Eurasia from 17 million years ago, their diets began to diversify as they adapted to the different environments they encountered, specializing in hard or soft fruit, or a mixture of both. Diet diversification increased in the late Miocene as the forests continued to fragment, as the seasons became more pronounced, and as deciduous trees gave way to evergreens in Eurasia. Preferred foods are all well and good when they're available, but fallback foods, critical for surviving the seasons of scarcity, have been a major driver of human evolution. When the dietary going gets tough, the tough get chewing. As with modern chimpanzees and gorillas, it seems that while Miocene apes preferred fruits, they ate hard nuts and seeds when nothing else was available. Let's call these tough time strategies. We'll return to them later, as they were truly the making of Homo sapiens. From 5 million years ago, we can see growing dietary diversification among the early ape bipeds, the Australopithecines, an early name for this group of southern ape men. Some bipeds, such as southern African Australopithecus africanus, have quite mixed microwear on their teeth, reflecting diets of various different plants, Others, such as Eastern African Australopithecus afarensis and Paranthropus boisei, have very homogeneous wear patterns, suggesting more specialized diets. One East African evolutionary path seems to have been from Australopithecus anamensis through Australopithecus afarensis to Paranthropus boisei, reflecting increasing efficiency at grinding tough food in large quantities. The Southern African Paranthropus robustus, by contrast, adopted a lowland gorilla-like diet, preferring soft fruits but roughing it on tough fruits during times of dearth. Isotopic analysis can be used to look even more specifically at diet. This is a versatile technique for examining the elemental or isotopic composition of solid materials. Colleagues and I used it to identify the sources of flint from which Ice Age tools were made in the UK, but it has also been used to reconstruct the diet of 1.8 million-year-old hominins from Swartkrans near to Johannesburg in South Africa. Since its discovery in the 1940s, this site has been famous for its many remains of Paranthropus robustus. Tiny samples from the teeth of several specimens were subjected to laser pulses to ablate, removed by vaporizing, the isotopes of carbon in them. Since different foods have different isotopic signatures, the researchers deduced that these hominins had a diet that changed with the seasons, from sedges, grass, seeds, and roots, to a modicum of meat. It's easy to see how the energetic improvements brought about by bipedalism were of great use. By at least 3.4 million years ago, some early human groups were obtaining meat from animals. Animal bones from archaeological sites dating to this period bear the hallmarks of being smashed open so that their fatty marrow could be eaten. By 2.5 million years ago, these smash marks were accompanied by straight cut marks, showing that meat was being carefully removed from bones too. The consumption of meat, marrow, and organs from small animals at least had become a regular part of the diet. There is plentiful evidence from this time of systematic carnivory. From a human point of view, the salad days were over. The consumption of larger animals is also known, although their remains are more partial, and the overabundance of their head parts relative to others on archaeological sites suggests that brain tissues were scavenged from the remains of carnivore kills of larger animals. Yum. It may be no coincidence that the first signs of deliberate use of fire occurred at around the same time as those of meat eating. With the exception of fruits, a source of easily digested sugars, eating raw food is not energetically efficient, despite modern fads. Only a small amount of nutrients from raw carbohydrates and proteins are digested by our gut, and some of these are fermented by microbes which consume a proportion of the available energy themselves. During digestion, we lose up to 50% of carbohydrate nutrients and as much as 100% of those from protein. Cooking, however, gets some of the digestion done artificially and can improve calorific intake by up to 50%. By breaking down carbohydrates in tubers and proteins in meat, cooking opens up a far wider range of foodstuffs for consumption which would otherwise be inedible or of limited nutritional benefit, and by destroying an army of potentially lethal foodborne bacteria such as E. coli, it also makes meat eating much safer. According to the anthropologist Richard Wrangham, cooking may have been the only way of guaranteeing survival through the dry seasons, and we can see it as another tough time strategy. Fire also deters dangerous predators, making it possible for an early human to sleep safely on the ground for the first time, and provides light that can be used to extend the hours available for socializing. Ultimately, the net effect was to lengthen the amount of time spent on communicating and reinforcing relationships, leading to the growth of the brain beyond that of other primates. Things begin to get really interesting by 2 million years ago. Back in 1962, the pioneering paleoanthropologists Lewis and Mary Leakey found the remains of an early hominin that seemed at the time to be the first tool user, hence they named it Handyman, Homo habilis. Up to that point, one of the few known hominin species had been the later upright man, or Homo erectus, discovered as far back as the 1890s in Sumatra, modern Indonesia. Since the Leakeys made their breakthrough, there has been a spate of new discoveries and a proliferation of differently named hominin species, particularly for our purposes, those later than Homo habilis, Homo rudolfensis, Homo ergaster, Homo georgicus, Homo erectus, Homo naledi, and Homo antecessor. The famous Neanderthals, Homo neanderthalensis, first identified in 1857 in the Neander Valley of Germany, appeared in Europe at much the same time as modern humans were evolving in Africa. We will encounter many of these names again as our story unfolds, but it's worth bearing in mind that researchers who spend many years hunting down these incredibly rare specimens often understandably have a tendency to want to give their hominin a brand new name to make it stand out. It is possible that some of these names will fall by the wayside in due course. By 1.9 million years ago, an ancestor to the earliest truly human-like humans had emerged in Africa in the form of Homo ergaster. This species had smaller teeth, chewing muscles, and bite forces. While the face was still large, the brain had enlarged to approaching half the size of our own, still a way to go, but already above the ape range and growing. Its body was larger, its legs longer. It was now fully committed to life on the ground, and its finely tuned and efficient bipedalism allowed Homo ergaster to range over longer distances in order to obtain food, which now included significant quantities of meat. An adaptive watershed had been reached. There are signs that these early forms of Homo had begun the dispersals out of Africa to which we shall return later. Homo georgicus was using an Alderwan toolkit, so named because the earliest discoveries of these simple stone tools were made in Olduvai Gorge, in the Caucasus by 1.5 million years ago, and Homo erectus had dispersed as far as China and Indonesia by 1.8 million years ago. These dispersals were short-lived and shut down when climates cooled once more, but the combination of an efficient bipedalism, weapon and tool-assisted hunting and butchery, and controlled use of fire had created a successful and competitive colonizer. The brain. We are metabolic prisoners of our large and expensive brains. They are 3.5 times larger than those of our closest primate relatives, the chimpanzees. They represent only 2% of our body mass, but they consume 15 to 20% of our total resting metabolism, compared to all other primates, 2 to 10%. Such an expensive tissue needs more energy than the life of a simple omnivorous primate can provide. There are several solutions: increase consumption of energy-rich foods, meat, particularly fat, render otherwise inedible foods edible, and more foods easier to digest, efficient butchery and cooking, and trade off energy from other expensive tissues, such as muscles or the stomach. These were all achievements of Homo ergaster. As mammals mature into adulthood, the complexity of the connections between their neurons changes as some are lost and others emerge. Chimpanzee and human brains develop in similar ways, both relatively slowly. Some neuron regions mature by the age of 3 to 4, while others don't until as late as 12, and fine-tuning occurs as late as 14. At the other end of the primate spectrum, macaques' brains mature quickly, shortly after birth. There is an important reason for our slow and ponderous neural maturation, which relates to what neuroscientists call neural plasticity, a rather grand term describing how numerous roots are created through the neurons while others are pruned back, which results in a very flexible way of thinking. We might call it effective problem solving. A similar process may have occurred in other mammals who have evolved relatively large brains, such as elephants and some whales, but it's not just size that counts. As body size gets bigger, so do brains, but not all regions of the brain scale up to the same degree. Our brains have grown particularly in the cerebral cortex, the outer layer, where much of our thinking and memory-related activities occur. The need for flexible brain power must have been intense, but why? From an evolutionary perspective, we must assume that the metabolic costs of enlarged brains were outweighed by the benefits. Brains certainly come in useful for acquiring food and for avoiding predators and infections, a sure sign of the dangerous world our ancestors inhabited. Cutting-edge genetic comparisons between human, chimpanzee, and rhesus monkey gene expression in the brain and other tissues, the process by which DNA instructions are converted into a functional product like a protein, have established the differences that distinguish the human genome. Short DNA sequences called HARs, human accelerated regions, related to particular areas of the brain underwent rapid change, i.e. acquired more DNA substitutions, more than would be expected in comparison with other primates. Research is at an early stage, but it's looking like a number of HARs relate to the production of general purpose cells that can turn themselves to many uses depending on what's going on in the environment, and a lot of these purposes involve cognition. A more specific example of a HAR is dopamine, a neurotransmitter related to improved working memory and the ability to plan and reason. Other cells relate to improvements in finger dexterity, social learning, and tool use. Put simply, a neuronal rewiring and the resulting ability to solve problems flexibly seems to be what really separates us from our closest primate relatives. Archaic Homo was well on this road, but it was a road strewn with some danger. For example, modern conditions such as ADHD, epilepsy, and dyslexia occur when a single gene, AUTS2, malfunctions. There is sometimes a cost to pay when playing with neurological fire. It's not quite that simple, though. If this were the case, wouldn't all mammals find increasingly large brains desirable? This is where we read the evolutionary small print. All benefits come with an associated cost, in this case, a metabolic one, and it doesn't come cheap. In evolutionary terms, it's no use to have one brainy individual who is a little better than others at predicting where an edible animal might be. The benefit of intelligence will only outweigh its costs if the whole group benefits. The key has been provided by the evolutionary psychologist Robin Dunbar. In his social brain hypothesis, he has proposed that increased brain size allows the maintenance of larger numbers of social relationships, and hence the development of larger social groups. The more complex relationships with individuals become, and the larger the number of relationships that need to be maintained, the greater the mental cost. Thus, the larger the brains, the greater the number of individuals who can live together cooperatively. It's easy to imagine the benefits of living in larger groups. Protection from predators and competitors is simpler, and the greater availability of mates could reduce the chances of inbreeding. But large groups come at a cost, and this would be prohibitively expensive if individuals were still deriving their metabolic energy solely from plant foods. Vegetarianism works in modern varied diets, but not on a seasonally changing savanna. One solution to the problem of how to power larger brains would be to focus on smaller packages of nutritious food that were relatively easy to digest in smaller guts, and that's where meat enters the picture. An important question is whether the differences that distinguish us from other apes arose gradually or abruptly. Recent research reveals that other great apes possess at least a rudimentary form of several aspects of the complex cognition thought to be unique to humans. This implies that our mental abilities evolved gradually, at least in the early stages. The two-man team of paleoanthropologist Tom Wynne and evolutionary psychologist Fred Coolidge have pioneered the study of our mental evolution, arguing that it all began in neural wiring that evolved to support the dexterous manipulation of objects. Once you can do that, you can make and use tools, and the earliest archaeological evidence shows that stool tools were being made by 3.3 million years ago. Stone tool manufacture is not easy and requires much practice. I've never been any good at it. Evolutionary researchers attach a lot of importance to technology. Unlike bones and other organic materials, stone tools are virtually indestructible. As a result, they are fairly common archaeologically, and they can be used to establish how early humans were thinking as they solved technical problems. As we'll see later, language is another thing that distinguishes us from apes, but it doesn't fossilize, and we can't study its origins directly. Thankfully, toolmaking and language share overlapping neural circuits in the brain, probably because they both involve complex, goal-focused action, and the increasing importance of teaching the skills of stone toolmaking probably played an important role in the cognitive development of language. Today, sophisticated neuroimaging techniques such as MRI scans can be used to map the neurological demands of even the simplest stone technology. MRI scanners are big, however, and it's not possible to get students to nap stone tools while lying inside their claustrophobic magnets. Instead, they are trained to make stone tools of different technological sophistication, and while in the scanner, they are presented with a series of technical questions that stimulate what they understand of particular techniques. In this way, the MRI and other scans build up three-dimensional maps of the areas of their brains that are active when thinking of each specific question. By scanning the students' brains at three points, at the start of their training, during it, and at the end, the paleoanthropologist Dietrich Stout and his team were able to show that as napping skills improved from the manufacture of random sharp flakes to shaped hand axes, structural changes occurred in the brains of the subjects. Activity increased as they practiced intensively during the first two stages, then decreased in the third. The simplest technology requires little beyond an ape brain other than an ability to pay close visual attention to blocks of stone and a degree of dexterity in manipulating them as they are struck. But the manufacture of hand axes requires considerably more cognitive control in the brain's prefrontal cortex. It needs an ability to envisage a specific shape and to control the hands in three dimensions carefully enough to impose that shape on the material. To make a hand axe required the ability to plan sequences of actions. The technological brain had been born. So far, the earliest known tools come from Lomekwi 3 in Kenya, and were probably made by one of those bipedally walking apes, Kenyanthropus platyops. In a mixed woodland and bush thicket, large cobbles of stone were struck against each other, rather like how chimpanzees use them to crack nuts. But in this case, the sharp flakes that had broken off were used to cut foods. This is very simple technology and may not even have been that common, but it already required good motor control of the hands. A huge mental leap occurred with Homo ergaster, with the inferior prefrontal cortex of the brain, which is concerned with attention and predicting the effects of actions, coming into its own. Now, the brain's increasing ability to perceive three-dimensional blocks of stone and to impose an imagined shape on them was brought to bear on the creation of the hand axe, a calling card of Homo ergaster. Hand axes are one of the perennial celebrities of early Ice Age archaeology, dispersed in the hands of this species and later archaic hominins such as Homo erectus and Homo heidelbergensis, which would ultimately see them distributed from their 1.8 million-year-old roots in southern and eastern Africa as far as Britain to the north and China to the east. Although of varied size and shape, they were the dominant stone technology for 1.5 million years, an all-round general-purpose tool. Why they varied in space and time is often debated, but their importance is that they mark a point when humans began a continuous process of reflection and evaluation about the technology they created. No longer were their stone tools quickly made, used and forgotten with little reflection. They were the creation of a mindset that had begun to think about functional efficiency in ways that are central to our modern experience. We've come a long way in a brief chapter, and we'll have to wave goodbye to the apes, who of course swung and knuckle-walked along their own evolutionary paths. There is much, of course, that I've left out, but I've emphasized the evolutionary developments I think important to the story of Homo sapiens. These took a branch-swinging, fruit-eating ape and turned it over the course of 5 million years or so into a large-brained, human-bodied, omnivorous problem-solver living in increasingly larger and more social groups. Those tough-time strategies required by the fragmentation of forested ape habitats brought about simple and later effective bipedalism, and freed up the brain to begin growing. That growth was paid for with nutritionally rich foods, facilitated by technological solutions, including stone tool production and the control of fire. By 500,000 years ago, something very new was about to appear. Chapter 2: The Molecular Frontier. It is said that in the famous Oxford evolution debate of 1860, in which Thomas Henry Huxley debated Charles Darwin's notion of evolution through natural selection with Bishop Samuel Wilberforce, Wilberforce asked Huxley if it was through his mother's or his father's line that he claimed to be descended from a monkey. He should have referred to apes, of course, rather than monkeys, but the point was made. Monkey and ape ancestry, what a preposterous idea. Little did the bishop know that the idea of human evolution would gain traction, and in little more than a century, the controversy would be settled, with our African ape origins clarified beyond doubt by molecular science. My own, albeit somewhat more modest, molecular revelation occurred another half century after that. In 2007, I had my mitochondrial DNA sequenced. I was co-leading a team investigating the biology of the earliest agriculturalists to spread into Europe and replace the old hunting and gathering way of life. We were undertaking various molecular and isotopic analyses of human remains from a small cemetery associated with the 7,000-year-old village of Idrovice in the Czech Republic. We had the skeletons of some 80 humans to work with, establishing their biological origins by sequencing their ancient DNA. The DNA analyses were being conducted by Barbara Bramanti, now of Ferrara University, and the first thing Barbara needed to do was to rule out the possibility that any of our team had contaminated the ancient samples with our own DNA while we were working with them. So it was not for vanity's sake that Barbara sequenced my mitochondrial DNA, but to allow her to minimize the risk of contamination. Barbara emailed me the results, congratulating me for the hunter-gatherer ancestry they revealed. The specifics of my DNA could not have been more pleasing. In technical terms, Barbara had discovered that I belong to haplogroup U5A1, which is nowadays a relatively rare set of genes and found in largest amounts in Central and Eastern Europe. We can think of U5 as a family of genes that had appeared by 30,000 years ago among the earliest Homo sapiens, populations to have arrived in Europe. Around 27,000 years ago, this genetic family split into two groups, of which U5A is one, which then spread further across Europe from around 20,000 years ago, from a source somewhere between the Pyrenees, Balkans, and Ukraine, and fragmented into several smaller groups in the last few thousand years of the Ice Age. It is no exaggeration to say that the U5 haplogroup is the true genetic representative of hunter-gatherers in Europe, having survived dilution by subsequent waves of those newfangled agriculturalists after the Ice Age. These findings revolutionized how I saw myself, just as the revolutions of science have in turn revealed new amazing insights into the African origins of Homo sapiens. Frontiers of archaeological science. To study human evolution is to study human variation. What makes us all different has very deep roots, and these can be traced back to Africa, where in the case of Homo sapiens, they began unfolding around 300,000 years ago. Some Ice Age specialists research biological variation: diet, ecology, anatomy, cognition. Others, like me, research behavioral variation: technology, settlements, survival, strategies, art, treatment of the dead. Ice Age specialists have long been used to working with bones, stones, and sediments, but when I started my career in the 1990s, it hadn't dawned on me that I would need to become literate in cutting-edge science. The study of the Ice Age was changing rapidly. Although revolution is an overused word in science, it's justified to say that archaeology has gone through one over the last two decades, and because there is so little evidence preserved, the further one goes back, Ice Age archaeology has always been at the forefront of scientific innovation. Science has transformed the field. Now, geneticists, isotope geochemists, climatologists, physicists, statisticians, and a host of other hard scientists contribute to our understanding of humanity's long-term evolution. Not that it's an easy process. Scientists form cliques like any other group, and the sudden explosion of radical new techniques, such as the sequencing of ancient DNA, and the totally new insights these often provide into our origins, can ruffle more feathers than Archaeopteryx in flight. We're still developing a rapport between the extremely wide range of different sciences that contribute to the very foundations of archaeology. The transformation began in the 1980s, towards the end of which I began to study archaeology at university. Archaeological scientists were beginning to talk of molecules, groups of atoms that form the smallest units into which substances can be divided. A battery of scientific techniques that can be deployed to analyze archaeological remains at the molecular level were starting to make their mark on the past. Among the topics of interest were isotopes, atoms of the same element that differ in their mass and physical properties, and by the time that I came to work as the resident archaeologist in Oxford's radiocarbon dating laboratory, stable isotope analysis was being rolled out to better understand the evolution of human diet. Ancient DNA analysis began at the same time, and by the late 1990s, the first genetic sequences of extinct humans were being produced. It is hard to keep up with the stunning advances of paleogenetics, accounts of which read like a sci-fi novel. By the 2000s, proteomics, the study of the complete set of proteins made by an organism, was also being used to establish to what species even the smallest fragments of ancient bone belonged. Unstable things. What molecular decay reveals about human origins? Archaeologists researching periods when people wrote things down and put dates on coins and inscriptions can usually date things quite precisely, sometimes to a specific year. Even where sources differ, they can be compared and accurate chronologies generated. We know that the boy king Tutankhamun died in about 1323 BC, the Emperor Augustus in AD 14, and that England was conquered by the Normans in AD 1066. But Ice Age people didn't record dates that can be traced forward to the present. Specialists in this epoch deal with vast stretches of time. For the origins of Homo sapiens, we have to look back at least 300,000 years. For the earliest dispersals of our species out of Africa, at least 100,000 years. For the earliest dispersal into Europe, at least 40,000 years. And even 12,000 years for the end of the Ice Age. Certainly, it's a fraction of time compared to the history of life on Earth, but it's still vast and hazy. In order to date sites, fossils, and archaeological objects that predate written history, we're dependent on a variety of laboratory dating techniques that rely on radioactive decay in the materials we're interested in. They are expensive, but essential if we're to locate our sites and materials in time and make sense of it all. The beauty of these techniques is that
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.